Good morning, students. Welcome to Best College Online Classes. In this video lecture, we are going to discuss about the process of production of gametes in female human being, that is oogenesis. Already we started this topic in last class, and already we discussed some concepts that are essential in the oogenesis. In last class, I gave you the definition for oogenesis, and after that, what are the sequential events that takes place simultaneously inside the ovary, that is to form ovarian follicles, which in turn modifies into primary follicle, secondary follicle, tertiary follicle, and finally a mature Graafian follicle, that all we discussed in last class. And after completion of that, in this class, we have to discuss about the next one. Observe this diagram already which you drawn in last class. That is about the formation of primary follicles, secondary follicles, and all. Now we will continue about the same topic, oogenesis. Here, in this topic, oogenesis. Once again, just to recall what we discussed in last class, this diagram already I gave you in last class. Now same thing we will repeat. So the oogenesis is very complex process, and it is a long time taking process. This oogenesis is actually begins during the 7th month of fetal life, during 7th month of fetal life in a female. Okay, so in female human being, when the 7th month of embryonic development begins inside the uterus of mother, then only the oogenesis will begin, but it will be completed only after puberty, that you have to remember. So even it begins in the 7th month of embryonic development or fetal life, so before birth of a female only the oogenesis will begin in the female ovaries, but that will be completed only after puberty. What is the age of puberty in female? 10 to 12 years. Only after that age only the production of ova will begin by a female. Okay, that you have to remember. Now this is the ovary which already I gave you. Ovary is externally covered by germinal epithelium. This germinal epithelium possesses primordial germ cells. Primordial germ cells are female germ cells. In the oogenesis, there are three phases. As I gave you in last class, the first phase is multiplication phase, which is followed by growth phase, and the final phase is maturation phase. So there are three phases: multiplication phase, growth phase, and maturation phase. In multiplication phase, what will happen here? The primordial germ cells are female germ cells, will undergo repeated mitotic divisions. The female, in the female ovary, in the germinal epithelium, the primordial germ cells are female germ cells, undergo repeated mitotic divisions, that leads to formation of a couple of million of oogonia, are 2 millions of oogonia in each ovary. 2 millions of oogonia form in each ovary. And after completion of that, there is no chances for adding of oogonia further in the lifetime of a female. So the oogonia will form only once. Later, there will be no chance to add the oogonia further. There is no chances for that. So all oogonia will form in the fetal life only by multiplication divisions or mitotic divisions, that you have to remember here. And after formation of a couple of oogonia in each ovary, then what will happen? This oogonia will enter inside the cortex of the stroma of ovary. So here, these are found on the surface, but that will enter into the cortex. That will enter into the cortex in the form of a chain of oogonia or in the form of a plug of oogonia, which I gave you as egg tube of plugger. Observe here, egg tube of plugger. What is this egg tube of plugger? The oogonia will enter into the cortex of the ovary in the form of a tube or in the form of a plug. That is known as egg tube of plugger. And immediately after enter into the cortex, the oogonia which are present in the cortex, that will modifies into a round mass of oogonia, which is known as egg nest, which is known as a egg nest, that I gave you in last class. Okay, So in the form of egg tube of Langer, the bubonia will enter into the cortex of the ovary. After enters into the cortex of the ovary, this egg tube of Langer will modifies into a round mass of bubonia, which is known as egg nest, which is known as egg nest. So after formation of egg nest, up to that which phase is completed? The phase of multiplication is completed. What will happen in the phase of multiplication? The primordial germ cells undergo repeated mitotic divisions. The primordial germ cells undergo repeated mitotic divisions that leads to formation of a couple of million of bubonia. This bubonia will enter into the cortex of the ovary in the form of egg tube of Langer. Immediately after enters into the cortex, this bubonia, which are in the form of egg tube of Langer, will modifies into a round mass of bubonia, which is known as egg nest. And after formation of egg nest, in each egg nest, only one bubonium, usually which is large in size, that bubonium will start increase in the size, that is growth. So in each egg nest, one bubonium will begin growth phase, that will grow in size and modifies into primary oocyte. Observe here, in this egg nest, only one bubonium will grow in size and modifies into primary oocyte. Already I gave you in previous classes. So first there is a primordial germ cells. This primordial germ cells undergo repeated mitotic divisions that leads to formation of oogonia or egg mother cells. Oogonia or egg mother cells. And after this oogonia or egg mother cells, what next here is oogonia will modifies into primary oocyte, which are all diploid in nature. They possess 46 chromosomes. So here it is also diploid, it has 46 chromosomes. It is also diploid, which possesses 46 chromosomes. And this primary oocyte also diploid, which possesses 46 chromosomes are there, that you have to keep in your mind here. So first, primordial germ cells undergo repeated mitotic divisions that leads to formation of more number of oogonia. In each ovary, how many will form? In each ovary, 2 million of oogonia will form. Later, in this, oogonia will grow in size and modifies into primary oocyte. Oogonia will grow in size and modifies into primary oocyte that we discussed in last class already. And after formation of this oogonia, what will happen here? If one oogonium will modifies into primary oocyte, so in each egg nest, only one oogonium will grow in size and modifies into primary oocyte. After formation of primary oocyte, what is the fate of remaining oogonia here? The remaining oogonia which are present in this egg nest will lose their ability to modify as a primary oocyte, because this primary oocyte secretes some inhibitory chemicals that stop remaining oogonia to modify as a primary oocyte. So immediately after formation of primary oocyte, this primary oocyte secretes some inhibitory chemicals. That inhibitory chemicals inhibits the modification of remaining oogonia or growth of remaining oogonia, and that avoid the formation of further primary oocyte here. Only one primary oocyte will form in each egg nest. And after formation of primary oocyte, what is the fate of this oogonia which lost their ability to modify into primary oocyte? What is the fate of that? Here, the oogonia which are present around primary oocyte will modifies into a flat cell layer around the primary oocyte. This flat cell layer is known as follicular epithelium, what I already gave you. Okay, so flat cells. So the oogonia will become flat cells and that form a layer around the primary oocyte, which is known as follicular epithelium. And this follicle, which is surrounded by a single layer of follicular epithelium. If you observe here, the primary oocyte is surrounded by a single layer of flat follicular epithelium. This follicle is known as primordial follicle. So, in the formation of a mature or graafian follicle, there are many stages. Primordial follicle will modify into primary follicle, primary will modify into secondary follicle will modify into tertiary follicle. Then this tertiary follicle finally modifies into a mature follicle or graafian follicle. Okay, so that you have to remember. Now here, primordial follicle is formed. What is primordial follicle? If the primary oocyte is surrounded by a single layer of flat follicular epithelium, that follicle is known as primordial follicle. So what is primordial follicle? In the follicle where the primary oocyte is surrounded by a single layer of flat follicular epithelium. Is known as primordial follicle. Is it clear? The formation of primordial follicle here. So primordial follicle is formed. After formation of primordial follicle, what is the use of these cells of follicular epithelium here? Around the primary oocyte, there is formation of flat cells of follicular epithelium. This follicular epithelium is essential for the protection and nourishment of primary oocyte. So primary oocyte is protected and nourished by follicular epithelium. You have to notice these are nothing but oogonia. Oogonia only modified as a follicular epithelium that are essential for the nourishment and the protection of primordial follicle. That's clear. Primordial follicle. What is primordial follicle? Once again, I am repeating. What is primordial follicle? The follicle in which the primary oocyte is surrounded by a single layer of flat follicular epithelium. Primordial follicle. What is primordial follicle? The follicle in which primary oocyte is surrounded by a single layer of follicular epithelium. All these are important for your competitive exams only, but not for your PUC. That you have to keep in your mind. For your PUC, all these are not there. Mainly for NEET examination, these are useful. Remember, okay. After formation of primordial follicle, what will happen? After formation of primordial follicles, this flat cells which are present in the follicular epithelium will become cuboidal. That will grow in size and modifies into large cuboidal cells. The flat, usually maybe studied in first year, in epithelial tissue there are different types. Flat epithelial tissues are squamous. So we can notice this as a squamous epithelium, but here this modified is a cube-like cells. So it is a cuboidal epithelium, cuboidal cells. So the squamous cells or flat cells became cuboidal and large in size. Now the primary oocyte is surrounded by a single layer of cuboidal cells which are known as granulosa cells. So primary oocyte is surrounded by a single layer of cuboidal cells which are developed from the flat or squamous cells of follicular epithelium. Once again I am repeating. Follicular epithelial cells which are flat or squamous that will modify into large cuboidal cells around the primary oocyte. These cells are known as granulosa cells. So granulosa cells are formed here. Now this granulosa cells form a membrane around the primary oocyte which is known as membrana granulosa. So the granulosa, a single layer of granulosa cells form a membrane around the primary oocyte, which is known as membrana granulosa. Is it clear? Membrana granulosa. What is membrana granulosa? A layer of cuboidal granulosa cells that surrounds the primary oocyte is known as membrana granulosa. Or the granulosa cells form a layer of membrane, a single layer membrane around the primary oocyte in this stage, that is known as membrana granulosa. So now this follicle, where the primary oocyte is surrounded by membrana granulosa, this one where the primary oocyte is surrounded by membrana granulosa is known as primary follicle. What is the difference between primordial follicle and primary follicle? In primordial follicle, the primary oocyte is surrounded by flat follicular epithelial cells layer, but whereas in the primary follicle, the primary oocyte is surrounded by cuboidal granulosa cells which form a membrane known as membrana granulosa. Membrana granulosa, is it clear? So membrana granulosa is formed here, right? That's clear. Membrana granulosa, that is the primary follicle. What is primary follicle? The follicle in which, what is primary follicle? Already I gave you primordial follicle. Now what is primary follicle? The follicle in which the primary oocyte is covered by a single layer of membrana granulosa. What is primary follicle? The follicle in which the primary oocyte is surrounded by a single layer of membrana granulosa. A single layer of membrana granulosa is primary follicle. Primary follicle. Right. Up to that we discussed in last class. And after formation of primary follicle, what will happen in the oocyte? This primary oocyte begins meiosis one. Actually, the primary oocyte begins meiosis one here. So when the primary oocyte begin meiosis one within the primary follicle, after formation of primary follicle, this primary oocyte start meiosis one. Meiosis one. It begins meiosis one, but it is an incomplete because it cannot be completed. And this meiosis one is temporarily arrested in diplotene of prophase one. Very important, ma. First resting phase. First resting phase in the oogenesis, that is in prophase one of meiosis one. So all these events takes place in the fetal life only, before birth only all these events takes place. Here once again listen, in the primary follicle, the primary oocyte begin meiosis one, but this meiosis one is temporarily arrested or temporarily stopped in the diplotene of prophase one of meiosis one. Okay, is it clear? Which is the first resting phase in the oogenesis, that is in meiosis one, prophase one. In prophase one, which phase? Diplotene. That you have to remember. So primary oocyte begins meiosis one, but this meiosis one is not completed here. It is temporarily arrested in the diplotene of prophase one of meiosis one. That you have to remember, right? And after that, what will happen here? Is it clear up to formation of primary follicle? So egg nest to primordial follicle, primordial follicle to primary follicle. And what are the changes done inside the oocyte? Here the primary oocyte is formed and primary oocyte start meiosis one, but that meiosis one is temporarily arrested in the diplotene of prophase one. Diplotene of prophase one. Now after that, what will happen here? This primary follicle will modify into secondary follicle. How the primary follicle will modify into secondary follicle, that we will notice here. So primary follicles are formed. Continue the diagram. Okay. So now a single layer of granulosa cells are present around the primary oocyte in the primary follicle. A single layer of granulosa cells. Or a single layer of membrana granulosa is present around the primary oocyte. But later, this membrana granulosa will modify into multi-layered structure. Multi-layered structure. Observe, same. It is primary oocyte which begins meiosis one, but this meiosis one is a incomplete one. Meiosis one is incomplete one, so it is temporarily arrested. That they may ask that question in exams, ma. In which follicle primary oocyte begins meiosis 1 or maturation divisions? Or they may ask, in which follicle the maturation phase begins? In which follicle the maturation phase begins? Primary follicle. And now it is the primary oocyte. Around the primary oocyte, before there was a single layer of membrana granulosa. Now this single layer of membrana granulosa is modifies into multi-layered. The single layer of membrana granulosa, observe here. Now it became multi-layered like that. So the single layer of membrana granulosa will modifies into a multi-layered membrana granulosa, because the cuboidal cells which are present here in single layer will undergo mitotic divisions, and that leads to formation of a multi-layered membrana granulosa. Multi-layered membrana granulosa around the primary oocyte. It is primary follicle, only a single layer of membrana granulosa is there, but now due to increase in the number of granulosa cells by undergoing mitotic cell division, there is formation of a multi-layered membrana granulosa around the primary oocyte. One thing you have to keep in your mind, where all these events take place, ma? All these events take place in the cortex of the ovary. Ovarian stroma is the internal space in the ovary, which is divided into outer cortex and inner medulla. All this growth and development of follicles takes place only in the cortex. Because of that only I gave you, cortex is granular. What are the granules? The granules are nothing but ovarian follicles, which are at various stages of development. So now the unilayer membrana granulosa became multilayered. So whenever the number of layers increases, here in the cortex, it is stroma. In this cortex and medulla, there is a stromal tissue. So stroma is usually filled by a loose stromal tissue. So whenever number of layers increases, that may create a pressure on the stromal tissue, which is present around that. That leads to condensation of stromal tissue, which is present in the stroma. Okay, whenever number of layers increase in the membrana granulosa, that leads to create a pressure on the stromal tissue that present around this, and that leads to formation of, that leads to condensation of stromal tissue like this. So now stromal tissue will condense around the membrana granulosa. So stromal tissue will condense around the membrana granulosa, that leads to formation of two more layers around this membrana granulosa. So it is the stromal tissue, is it clear? So these layers, which are formed by the stromal tissue, by the condensation of stromal tissue, there is formation of new layer around the membrana granulosa, which are known as theca layers. Which layers are these? Theca layers. How these theca layers are formed here? By the condensation of stromal tissue around the membrana granulosa, that leads to formation of theca layers. Theca layers. Is it clear? Whenever the number of layers increases in the membrana granulosa, that will create a pressure around the stromal tissue, which is present around it. That leads to formation of condensation of stromal tissue. That stromal tissue form a new layer around the membrana granulosa, which is known as theca layers. So theca layers are formed here. In this theca layer, again, it is divided into two, the inner layer, outer layer. Observe here carefully, it is inner layer and it is the outer layer. So the theca layers, which are formed by the condensation of stromal tissue, is divided into two parts. The inner layer is known as theca interna, and the external layer or outer layer is known as theca externa. So now how many layers are formed around the membrana granulosa? There is formation of theca layer. In this, the theca layer which is located inside is known as theca interna, and the layer which is present outside is known as theca externa. Theca interna and theca externa. Is it clear? So write down here, theca interna and theca externa. How many theca layers are formed here, ma? Two theca layers are formed. How these theca layers are formed? By the condensation of stromal tissue. By the condensation of stromal tissue, there is formation of two theca layers. The theca layer which is present inside or close to membrana granulosa, immediately after membrana granulosa, the theca layer which is present here is known as theca interna. Theca interna. And the layer which is located outside, or it is close to stromal tissue or oil stroma, that is theca externa. Theca externa. Theca interna and theca externa. Is it clear? So once again I am repeating here. In the primary follicle, there is a single layer of membrana granulosa or a single layer of granulosa cells that will undergo repeated mitotic divisions that leads to formation of a multi-layered of granulosa cells. A multi-layered membrana granulosa is formed. Whenever a multi-layered membrana granulosa will form, automatically that will create a pressure on the stromal tissue which is present in the ovarian stroma. And that leads to condensation of stroma of ovary, and this condensed tissue of stroma of ovary will modifies into two layers around the membrana granulosa. The inner layer is known as theca interna, and the outer layer is known as theca externa. So there is formation of how many theca layers? Two theca layers. What are that? Theca interna and theca externa. How these are formed? By the condensation of stromal tissue in the ovary. By the condensation of stromal tissue in the ovary. By the condensation of stromal tissue in the ovary, it is formed. That's clear. Now this follicle, which contain a multi-layered membrana granulosa and two theca layers, is known as secondary follicle. So now primary follicle is modified into secondary follicle. Primary follicle is modified into secondary follicle, that you have to remember here. Is it clear? The primary follicle is modified into secondary follicle. So what is secondary follicle here? The secondary follicle here, you see, the follicle in which the primary oocyte is surrounded by a multi-layered membrana granulosa along with two theca layers. Along with two theca layers is known as secondary follicle. So what is this follicle? This is a secondary follicle. Primary follicle is modified into secondary follicle now. Primary follicle is modified into secondary follicle. Once again, I am repeating you. What is a secondary follicle? The follicle in which primary oocyte is surrounded by a multi-layered membrana granulosa, along with two theca layers. Along with two theca layers is known as secondary follicle. Secondary follicle is formed. Is it clear? Now, what is the important function of theca interna and theca externa also you have to know. See, theca interna secretes the female reproductive hormone estrogen. So, very important, this secretes the estrogen in female. theca interna, theca interna secretes estrogen. Theca interna secretes the female reproductive hormone estrogen. What about theca externa? Theca externa is mainly for external protection and also it separates the follicle from the stromal tissue. The follicle will be separated from the stromal tissue by the theca externa. By the theca externa, the follicle is separated from the stromal tissue, and the theca interna secretes the female reproductive hormone estrogen. And after that, membrana granulosa. It is mainly for nourishment of oocyte. Nourishment of oocyte. Okay. So that also you have to remember here. Right, secondary follicle is formed. Observe here, in the secondary follicle, shall I erase this again once? So now observe here, I am drawing the secondary follicle. The granulosa layer which is present here will split into two layers, inner layer and outer layer, that leads to formation of a cavity, a fluid sorry for the moment. Right, now this theca interna, theca externa I give in the secondary follicle. Now after that, what will happen here? Observe here, it is the primary oocyte. Primary oocyte. Around the primary oocyte, observe it. It is a granulosa layer. It is membrana granulosa. So here, so this multilayer membrana granulosa will split Sorry, just observe here. So it is a multilayered membrana granulosa. That membrana granulosa will split into two layers, inner and outer layers. The inner layer and outer layer, after formation, leads to formation of a cavity here. Please. membrana granulosa.
So here the membrana granulosa
due to split in the membrana granulosa, that led to formation of an inner and outer granulosa layers, but that led to formation of a cavity inside it. That led to formation of a cavity which is actually not that cannot keep the oocyte center. That made the oocyte centric. We will discuss that later on. Just observe here once again. I'm repeating. The membrane granulosa which is present around the primary oocyte. The membrane granulosa which is present around the primary oocyte is divided into two layers. The inner layer and outer layer. That led to form a cavity around the this primary oocyte or inside the follicle. This formation of cavity. This cavity is immediately connected to the center of the granulosa cells. This granulosa cells immediately disappears there through it. And this cavity which is formed here is known as axon. Axon. So once again, I am repeating here. The membrane of granulosa cells will arrange or split into two layers, inner layer and outer layer. That leads to formation of a cavity. This cavity will immediately connect to fluid which is secreted by granulosa cells. Which is secreted by granulosa cells here, absolutely. Which is secreted by granulosa cells. This fluid is secreted by granulosa cells. And this fluid filled cavity which is present in the follicle. The fluid filled cavity which is present in the follicle is known as axon. And the follicle which contains the axon is known as tertiary follicle. The follicle which possesses is tertiary follicle. The follicle which possesses once again I am repeating here. The follicle once again listen. So the membrana granulosa is divided into both two layers or that split into two layers that leads to formation of a cavity inside the follicle. This cavity is immediately filled with a fluid that is secreted by granulosa cells. And now it is a fluid-filled cavity. The fluid-filled cavity is known as axon. What is axon? Axon is a fluid-filled cavity that is present in the follicle. The fluid-filled cavity which is present in the follicle is known as axon. And the follicle which contains this axon is known as tertiary follicle. And the follicle which contains this axon is tertiary follicle. What is tertiary follicle? Now secondary follicle will modify into which follicle mark? Tertiary follicle. What is the nature of tertiary follicle here? It is what? It is oocyte. Oocyte. Around the oocyte, before there are multi-layered membrane granulosa, the whole story is membrane granulosa cells, but which are arranged in a 2D like this also. So it is also membrane granulosa, but which is split here, that led to formation of, there is a gap between this, that leads to formation of a fluid filled cavity here. And this fluid is known as ductal follicle. The fluid which is present in this cavity is ductal follicle. This cell secretes this ductal follicle. Granulosa cells. This granulosa cells in membrana granulosa. The granulosa cells in membrana granulosa secretes ductal follicle is secreted by that. Have to remember, is it clear? So now this fluid cavity which is formed here is known as antrum. Antrum is the fluid filled cavity
present tandem is fluid keeping the cavity present in the follicles. That you have to remember here. That's clear. Next step. One more thing you have to remember here. Antrum is clear. What is antrum? Antrum is the fluid filled cavity which is filled by the fluid which is known as liquor follicle, which is secreted by the granular cells. Now, in this follicle, membrane and granules are the granular cells that are many pores. One inner layer and another one is outer layer. The newly formed inner layer can be observed in the It is actually membrane granulosa. It is antrum. Inside there is a new layer formed. This is known as corona radiata. Corona radiata. So there is formation of corona radiata. One more point. So there is formation of two layers by the splitting of membrane granulosa. The inner layer is known as corona radiata and the outer layer is common membrane granulosa. But what happened here? There is formation of the fluid cavity between corona radiata and membrane granulosa. And outside this membrane granulosa, which are present? There is pupa interna. Outside the pupa interna is pupa external. Pupa interna and pupa external. So observe now what are the layers present around the primary oocyte up to here. It is corona radiata, membrana granulosa, pupa interna, pupa external. Corona radiata, membrana granulosa, pupa interna and pupa externa. So four layers are formed. Now what is this follicle? It is a tertiary follicle. It is secondary follicle and it is primary follicle. So primary follicle is modified into secondary follicle. Secondary mode of follicle is modified into tertiary follicle. What is the important character of tertiary follicle? Presence of antrum. What is antrum? Antrum is the fluid filled cavity. So the sequence of membranes is very important. Now the oocyte is in tertiary follicle. Already I told you in secondary position there is formation of pupa interna and pupa externa. Whenever there is formation of pupa interna, that secretes estrogen. Immediately after secretion of estrogen in tertiary follicle, what will happen? The primary oocyte completes its first meiosis. The meiosis one is arrested. The meiosis one is temporarily arrested in mitotic or process one. But now In the tertiary follicle, the primary oocyte completes this meiotic division. Meiosis one will be completed, and that leads to formation of two unequal cells. It is a reductional division. Meiosis one is a reductional division. Observe carefully. So meiosis one. Once again, observe carefully here. In the tertiary follicle, the primary oocyte will restart meiosis one and it will complete meiosis one, and that leads to formation of two unequal size cells. The small size is known as first polar body. It is known as first polar body. And here it comes to this first polar body and here secondary oocyte. So secondary oocyte. Now once again I am repeating, after formation of tertiary follicle, in the tertiary follicle the primary oocyte will complete meiosis one. That leads to formation of two unequal cells. The small cell is first polar body and the large cell is secondary oocyte. So here it is actually reduction division. So both are haploid. One of the cells formed are haploid because only 23 chromosomes. There are only 23 chromosomes. Both process are 23 chromosomes. But here there is unequal cytokinesis takes place. Equal karyokinesis. Equal karyokinesis, but unequal cytokinesis. So the genetic material are chromosomes will be equally distributed, but the cytoplasm cannot be distributed equally. Most of the cytoplasm is present in the primary oocyte, remaining in the secondary oocyte only. Very little amount of cytoplasm will enter into first polar body. So most of the cytoplasm will distribute in secondary oocyte, and very little amount of cytoplasm will distribute by the first polar body. Why? Because first polar body cannot play any role in the formation of ovum. It cannot undergo further process and it cannot modify into ovum. It will modify into ovum, there is only secondary oocyte. Secondary oocyte only modifies into ovum in future, and whenever the fertilization takes place, this secondary oocyte will modify into ovum. Whenever fertilization takes place, then in early stages of fertilization, to nourish the embryo, it requires more nutrients. Because of that, most of the cytoplasm is contained more nutrients will enter into secondary oocyte. By first polar body will be degenerated later. It does not play any role in the formation of ovum after this. The only role of first polar body here is to form a haploid secondary oocyte, to share the equal number of chromosomes that leads to formation of haploid secondary oocyte. Haploid secondary oocyte that we have to remember. So haploid secondary oocyte is formed. For that only there is formation of first polar body, but this polar body cannot modify into ovum in future. Is it clear? Where all responses take place in which follicle, that's three follicle. Is it clear? That's three is follicle. Did you get my point? So after formation of tertiary follicle, the primary oocyte will complete meiosis one, that leads to formation of two unequal cells, a small cell which is known as first polar body, a large cell that is the secondary oocyte. Why there is unequal cytokinesis takes place? Secondary oocyte only modifies into ovum future, which requires more nutrients to nourish the early embryonic stages. Because of that, most of the cytoplasm from primary oocyte will enter into secondary oocyte. But this first polar body will be degenerated as soon as it does not come into ovum because of the very less amount of cytoplasm will enter into due to lack of nourishment. Because less cytoplasm is there, no. So due to lack of nourishment and due to lack of food, this first polar body will be degenerated later. Okay, we will discuss the details of that also later. Just remember up to this. Okay. Next, what happens immediately after formation of secondary oocyte? The secondary oocyte itself secretes a protective non-cellular glycoprotein layer on this. The secondary oocyte itself secretes one more layer on this for the protection. This layer, observe around the secondary oocyte, now I have one layer here, this one. That is known as zona pellucida. Is it? Zona pellucida. Here, this layer which is formed here is zona pellucida. Zona pellucida. So a new non-cellular layer. Which is where the glycoproteins is secreted by secondary oocyte itself around it. That is known as zona pellucida. And after zona pellucida, which is there, it is a chroma radiator, already I told you. The newly formed layer by the splitting of membrane of granulosa cells is chroma radiator. And after chroma radiator, membrane of granulosa. And after membrane of granulosa, the peak item. And outside the peak item, the peak item is there. So the sequence is very important. Which is the layer that present immediately outside the oocyte, zona pellucida. After zona pellucida, what is the layer? Here it comes out. Here, what is this? This is corona radiator. Corona radiator. And after corona radiator, already ग्लोसा and outside the membrane gland is a theca interna. Outside the theca interna, theca externa. This sequence, which is the closest layer to the oocyte and which is the closest layer to the stroma of the ovary. That also you have to remember. Once again, you will write this sequence. I am telling, I am repeating here. Immediately after oocyte, oocyte is surrounded by zona pellucida. Zona pellucida. Outside the zona pellucida, corona radiata. After corona radiata, there is antrum, the fluid filled cavity. And after this antrum, membrana granulosa. Membrana granulosa. And outside the membrana granulosa, theca interna. And after theca interna, theca externa. Theca interna, theca externa. So from outside, I am giving the sequence once again. Before I gave you sequence from inside, now I am giving sequence from outside. Outermost layer in the testicular follicle, theca externa. Inside to that, theca interna. Inside to that, membrana granulosa. Inside membrana granulosa, corona radiata. Inside corona radiata, zona pellucida. So from inward to outward, outward to inward direction is very important. So once again, this is the innermost layer. Zona pellucida, after zona pellucida, corona radiata, after corona radiata, membrana granulosa, after membrana granulosa, theca interna, and outside the theca interna, theca externa. So that you have to remember the reason. Anatomy is present between which layers in the testicular follicle? Anatomy is present between which layers in the testicular follicle? Which layers? Corona radiata and membrana granulosa. Corona radiata and membrana granulosa. So now corona radiata and membrana granulosa are separated to the antrum. Antrum separated the corona radiata and membrana granulosa. Already I told you the main source of nourishment for the oocyte is this membrana granulosa. Now membrana granulosa and corona radiata are separated means oocyte also separated. Then how will this oocyte will get nourishment here? Then how oocyte will get nourishment here? Then how to know here? So, see, in between corona radiata and membrana granulosa. Membrana granulosa is only corona radiata. Now, in between corona radiata and membrana granulosa, there is formation or there is extension of some granulosa like granulosa cells like a bridge. Some granulosa cells exchange between membrana granulosa and corona radiata. So membrana granulosa and corona radiata are connected by some granulosa cells. So here membrana granulosa is between corona radiata. Both are separated by fluid cavity and corona. But to form a connectivity between membrana granulosa and corona radiata, some granulosa cells from the membrana granulosa extend up to corona radiata. So granulosa cells extend from the membrana granulosa to corona radiata are known as tumulus oophorus. Tumulus oophorus, important one. What is the tumulus oophorus? The granulosa cells which extends from the membrana granulosa to corona radiata. The elevated granulosa cells from the membrana granulosa to corona radiata is known as tumulus oophorus. Once again, I am repeating, what is tumulus oophorus? The elevated granulosa cells from membrana granulosa to the elevated granulosa cells from membrana granulosa to corona radiata. The elevated granulosa cells from membrana granulosa to corona radiata are known as tumulus oophoricus. What is the use of this tumulus oophoricus? Mainly here, the tumulus oophoricus forms a connectivity between membrana granulosa and corona radiata. The elevated granulosa cells from membrana granulosa to corona radiata is cumulus oophoricus. Cumulus oophoricus, that we have to remember. So once again I will repeat, it is a secondary oocyte. Immediately after secondary oocyte, there is a non-cellular protective glycoprotein layer is secreted by oocyte itself, that is a zona pellucida. So after oocyte, zona pellucida, which is formed by corona radiata, and after corona radiata, membrana granulosa, theca interna, theca externa are present. 5 layers. Innermost zona pellucida, and after that corona radiata, and after that membrana granulosa, theca interna, theca externa. Zona pellucida, corona radiata, membrana granulosa, theca interna, theca externa are 5 layers. And in between membrana granulosa and corona radiata, a fluid-filled cavity antrum is present in necessary follicle. And the elevated granulosa cells in between membrana granulosa and corona radiata is known as cumulus oophoricus. Cumulus oophoricus. And one more thing you have to notice here, after formation of secondary oocyte, this secondary oocyte will immediately begin meiosis II. Secondary oocyte will begin meiosis II. But this meiosis II is temporarily arrested in metaphase. So it is second receiving phase of oogenesis. So here meiosis II is begun. Here meiosis II is begun, but this meiosis II is temporarily arrested. In which phase? Metaphase. It is the second resting phase. Why it is arrested in meiosis II, and when it will be restart, and when the meiosis II will be completed and the ovum will be formed? We will discuss all that after completion of formation of mature follicle or tertiary follicle. Tertiary follicle will form. This tertiary follicle will modify into the matured follicle or graafian follicle. Matured follicle or graafian follicle, that we will discuss. And after completion of that, we will go for the remaining discussion in oogenesis. Before going to start the formation of the matured follicle or graafian follicle, take a short break. Okay.
Continue the same topic. The formation of follicles along with the modifications in the oocyte, the changes in the oocyte, both we are discussing here. So here observe once again, there is formation of tertiary follicle. Secondary follicle is modified into tertiary follicle. In the secondary follicle, what are the membranes present around the primary oocyte? In the secondary follicle, primary oocyte is surrounded by a multi-layered membrana granulosa, which is followed by theca interna and followed by theca externa. So total 3 layers are present around the primary oocyte. And what about in the secondary oocyte? What about in the secondary oocyte? Or this primary oocyte will complete meiosis I in tertiary follicle, that leads to formation of secondary oocyte. So it is primary follicle, and in secondary follicle, what are the membranes present? In the secondary follicle, there are 3 membranes: membrana granulosa, theca interna, theca externa. And what about in tertiary follicle? In tertiary follicle, there is zona pellucida, corona radiata, membrana granulosa, theca interna, theca externa. Total 5 layers are there. How many membranes are there around the oocyte in the tertiary follicle? 5 membranes. Which is the innermost membrane that present around the oocyte? That is zona pellucida. After zona pellucida, corona radiata. After corona radiata, membrana granulosa. After membrana granulosa, theca interna. And outermost is theca externa. In between corona radiata and membrana granulosa, there is a fluid-filled cavity which is known as antrum. The presence of antrum is the character of which follicle? Tertiary follicle. And to connect membrana granulosa and corona radiata, some granulosa cells are elevated. Some granulosa cells are elevated from the membrana granulosa to corona radiata, that are known as cumulus oophoricus. Cumulus oophoricus. The elevated granulosa cells from membrana granulosa to corona radiata are known as tubules vocalicus that connects the membrana granulosa and corona radiata. Up to that, tertiary follicle is formed. In tertiary follicle, what will happen? The primary follicle restart meiosis one, which is arrested in the prophase one, diploid phase of prophase one, and it leads to formation of two unequal cells, one small and one large cell. The small one is known as first polar body, and the large cell is second. Secondary oocyte. So primary oocyte completes meiosis one. Actually, meiosis one is begin in the primary follicle. But it is temporarily arrested in the diploid of prophase one. But when it is restarts, where it will restarts? It will restarts in the tertiary follicle, and it will be completed in the tertiary follicle. They may ask in competitive exams, ma, the first maturation division or meiosis one, where the meiosis one or first maturation division will begins, and where it will complete. So the first meiotic division or meiosis one begins in the primary follicle, but it is temporarily arrested in the diploid of prophase one. But it will be completed in the tertiary follicle. Okay, begins in the primary follicle but completed in tertiary follicle. That leads to formation of two unequal cells. The small one is first polar body and the large one is second polar body. Here what we have to notice is there is equal karyokinesis. Both receive same number of chromosomes. Both are haploid. Both receive 23 chromosomes. But it is unequal cytokinesis. Takes place. Most of the cytoplasm, which is rich in the nutrients, it is highly nutrient cytoplasm. Most of the cytoplasm will enter into the secondary oocyte, and very little amount of cytoplasm enters into the first polar body. Why? Because of unequal cytokinesis only, there is formation of two unequal cells, first polar body, a small first polar body and a large secondary oocyte. And what about the fate of these two? The secondary oocyte will undergo meiosis two and modifies into ovum. But the first polar body does not participate in the formation of ovum, and due to lack of sufficient amount of cytoplasm or due to lack of sufficient amount of nutrients or food, this first polar body will be pushed towards a pole. Why it is named as polar body? This will be pushed towards a pole in the egg. The egg, for example, we will see there are two poles. I will give you at the time of discussing about the structure of ovum. Here, one pole, it is another pole. This is animal pole, it is vegetal pole. Here, as yolk is, you know, yellow color nutritive substance, highly nutrient substance, yellow color. So this pole where more yolk is distributed is vegetal pole. And where this first polar body will be pushed, that is known as animal pole. So why this is named as polar body? Because after formation it does not have any role in the ovulation or in the production of ovum. Because of that, it will be pushed towards a pole, so it is named as polar body. Is it clear? So the first polar body is haploid, it has 23 chromosomes, and secondary oocyte also haploid and it also possesses 23 chromosomes. But most of the cytoplasm from the primary oocyte remain in the secondary oocyte. Very less amount of cytoplasm will enter into the first polar body. So due to lack of nourishment or due to lack of food, this polar body will be degenerated in future. After completion of meiosis two, it will be degenerated. I will give you that. Just remember why it is named as polar body, because it will be just pushed towards a pole. Because of that, it is a polar body. So all this happened in tertiary follicle. And after formation of secondary oocyte in the tertiary follicle, In the tertiary follicle, secondary oocyte immediately begins. In the tertiary follicle, the secondary oocyte immediately begins meiosis II. Meiosis II. But this meiosis II is also incomplete. It cannot be completed immediately. That will be arrested in the metaphase. There, that will be arrested in the metaphase by the action of one protein, that is the metaphase promoting factor. Metaphase promoting factor. So metaphase promoting factor inhibits the meiosis II, which will be temporarily arrested in the metaphase. So metaphase promoting factor inhibits that, and it will be temporarily arrested in the metaphase. Second resting phase in the meiosis, that is secondary oocyte begins meiosis II, but due to metaphase release, metaphase promoting factor, MPF means metaphase promoting factor, meiosis II is arrested in metaphase. Meiosis I is arrested in diplotene phase of prophase I. Meiosis II is arrested in metaphase because of metaphase promoting factor. So second resting phase is completed. Tertiary follicle is formed. In the tertiary follicle, secondary oocyte is, secondary oocyte begins meiosis II, but which is temporarily arrested in metaphase. Once again, what you have to remember here, primary oocyte begin meiosis I in the primary follicle, but it is temporarily arrested in diplotene of prophase I, but it will be completed in the tertiary follicle. Meiosis I is completed in the tertiary follicle, that leads to formation of a small first polar body and large secondary oocyte. That is completed where meiosis I begin and where meiosis end. It begins in the primary follicle and it end at tertiary follicle. And where meiosis II begin and where it will be end, or if, where it will be completed. Meiosis II will begin in the tertiary follicle, but that cannot be completed in the ovary in human being. Meiosis II cannot be completed in the ovary. The meiosis II will be completed in the fallopian tubes. Very important that you have to remember. Meiosis II of secondary oocyte will be completed only in the fallopian tubes. That will be completed in the fallopian tubes. Now we will discuss it, how it will be completed in the fallopian tubes. Right? Once again, ma'am. This is tertiary follicle. Now what will happen in the tertiary follicle? So here, due to lack of space, I will modify this tertiary follicle only as a matured or a graafian follicle. Okay? So nothing will happen in the tertiary follicle to modify as a mature follicle or graafian follicle. Tertiary follicle will grow in size and modifies. This tertiary follicle will grow in size. Tertiary follicle will grow in size and modifies into a mature follicle or graafian follicle. Now the tertiary follicle is grow in size. Tertiary follicle will grow in size and modified into a mature follicle or graafian follicle. This is a matured follicle. You will write this diagram separately. Due to lack of space, I modify tertiary follicle into matured follicle or graafian follicle here. After completion of tertiary follicule, you will draw here a matured follicle or graafian follicle. That is a matured follicle or graafian follicle. Tertiary follicle will grow in size and modified into a mature follicle or graafian follicle. That will modify into a matured follicle or graafian follicle. A matured follicle, which was explained by R. Graaf, the scientist R. Graaf. Because of that, it was popular as a graafian follicle, based on the science, by the name of scientist who explained about the formation and all details of this matured follicle. R. Graaf. Or a graph, it is known as graafian follicle. Graafian follicle. So tertiary follicle is modified into graafian follicle. Tertiary follicle is modified into matured follicle or graafian follicle. Right, after formation of graafian follicle, what will happen? All these events takes place in the cortex of the ovary. Already I told you. Okay. So now the graphene follicle or mature follicle moves towards the surface of the ovary. So here it is moves towards the surface. Actually, in this diagram, it is the wall, no? So when you will compare, it will move towards the surface of the ovary. When it will move towards the surface of the ovary, that will create a pressure on the external wall of the ovary. So here it is the external wall. What is this? Theca here, tunica albuginea and germinal epithelium are there. So now, after formation, the graphene follicle or mature follicle will move towards the surface of the ovary. That will create a pressure on the surface membrane. That will create a pressure on the surface membrane. Finally, that leads to rupture of the surface membrane of the ovary. So now, the surface membrane of the ovary is ruptured. How? Because of the pressure which is exerted by the graphene follicle. So tertiary follicle will grow in size and modifies into a mature follicle or graphene follicle. After formation, this mature follicle or graphene follicle will move towards the surface, and that will create a pressure on the surface membrane of the ovary. Whenever it will create a pressure, that leads to rupture. That leads to rupture, or that leads to breakdown of surface membrane of ovary. And after completion of that, what will happen? After completion of that, by the action of one hormone, luteinizing hormone, LH. Now, the levels of LH hormones will increase in the body. Whenever the levels of luteinizing hormone will increase or that will reach to its maximum, then what will happen? The membranes which are present around oocyte will be ruptured. Observe here carefully. By the action of luteinizing hormone during the menstrual cycle, when the luteinizing hormone levels will be reached to its maximum levels, if the LH levels will reach it to its maximum, we can call that as the LH surge. LH surge, we will discuss that in the topic menstrual cycle. Just I am giving you what is the role of LH here. So first graphene follicle will move towards the surface of the ovary. That will create a force or pressure on the surface of the ovary. That leads to breakdown of, that leads to rupture of surface membrane of ovary. And after that, by the increase of LH levels, LH will causes for breakdown of membranes, or that causes for rupture of graphene follicle. Rupture of graphene follicle. Now, the secondary oocyte. Already I told you secondary oocyte begin meiosis 2, but which is arrested in metaphase. Now here, the secondary oocyte along with two layers, zona pellucida and corona radiata, will release into body cavity. Zona pellucida and corona radiata will release into body cavity. So from graphene follicle, what happened now? The secondary oocyte is released by the action of which hormone? LH hormone. So LH hormones rupture the theca externa, theca interna and membrana granulosa. That leads to release of secondary oocyte into body cavity. Along with which layers? Secondary oocyte releases into the body cavity along with zona pellucida and corona radiata. Important. Which of the following layers that remain with the secondary oocyte after, even after releasing into the body cavity? That is zona pellucida and corona radiata. And now one more thing you will remember here. Usually the releasing of ovum from the graphene follicle into body cavity or from the mature follicle into body cavity is known as ovulation. Ovulation is the release of ovum from the mature follicle or graphene follicle into body cavity. The release of ovum from the graphene follicle or mature follicle into body cavity is known as ovulation. That is a common definition for mammalian. But what about in human being? Is there a deformation of ovum here? Is it formed completely here? Ovum is not completely formed here. Ovum is not completely formed here. Observe carefully. Which is formed here only? That is secondary oocyte only formed here. So secondary oocyte only releasing in human being. But in other mammalians, directly ovum will releases into the body cavity. That is ovulation. What is the general definition for the ovulation? The release of ovum from the matured follicle or graafian follicle into body cavity is ovulation. But what about in human being? How could we define ovulation in human being? The release of secondary oocyte from graafian follicle into body cavity. Here secondary oocyte did not complete meiosis II, so there is no formation of ovum. Before formation of ovum only, the secondary oocyte will releases. The secondary oocyte will releases in the body cavity, that you have to remember. So there is a difference in the ovulation of human being and other mammalians. In other mammalians, there is releasing of ovum directly into the body cavity, but in human being, which stage will releases? Secondary oocyte. Write down definition for ovulation in human being. What is ovulation in human being? The release of secondary oocyte, not ovum. We cannot call this as the ovum here. But in other animals, in other mammalians, it is actually ovum. Secondary oocyte will complete meiosis II and forms the ovum. But here, secondary oocyte just begins the meiosis II, but which is temporarily arrested in the metaphase. So meiosis II is not yet completed. Before that only, what will happen? Secondary oocyte will releases from the graafian follicle into body cavity. Is it clear? What is ovulation? How to define ovulation in human being? The release of secondary oocyte from graafian follicle into body cavity. The release of secondary oocyte from graafian follicle into body cavity is known as ovulation in human being. Okay. Now, how this secondary oocyte and when this secondary oocyte will complete meiosis II and when the ovum will be produced here actually. So listen carefully. After release, this secondary oocyte will be collected by the fimbriae of infundibulum of fallopian tube. Already I gave you. On the surface of infundibulum, finger-like projections are there. That are fimbriae. Now the fimbriae will collect this secondary oocyte. Then secondary oocyte will enter into the fallopian tube. In the fallopian tube, secondary oocyte will reach to the ampulla. In the ampulla, when the sperm will come in contact, that stimulates the completion of meiosis II. Listen carefully. So here, where the meiosis II will be completed, that is in the fallopian tubes. Where it begins? It begins in the tertiary follicle, but it will be completed in the fallopian tubes, oviducts or fallopian tubes. So when the sperm will come in contact with the secondary oocyte, then what will happen? Then anaphase promoting factor will be released. Anaphase promoting factor. So before meiosis II is arrested in the metaphase because of releasing of metaphase promoting factor. But when the sperm will come in contact with the secondary oocyte in the fallopian tubes, then what will happen? Anaphase promoting factor will be produced. This anaphase promoting factor will causes for promoting the cell from metaphase to anaphase. Before it was arrested in the metaphase, now because of action of anaphase promoting factor, it will be enters into the anaphase and it will complete meiosis II. So where meiosis II will be completed, ma? In the fallopian tube, not in the ovary. In human being, in the ovary, the final process of formation of ovum cannot takes place. Where actually it takes place? It takes place in the fallopian tubes. Now secondary oocyte will complete meiosis II. Again that leads to formation of two unequal cells. Again that leads to formation of two unequal cells. Here also same. Equal equal karyokinesis but unequal cytokinesis. Secondary oocyte will undergo meiosis II. Meiosis II will be completed by the secondary oocyte in the fallopian tubes when the sperm will come in contact with the secondary oocyte. Now it is wooted, and it is second polar body. So there is formation of wooted and second polar body. Two unequal cells are formed by the completion of meiosis II. The small one is known as second polar body and the large one is wooted. Again this wooted will grow in size and modifies into ovum. Wooted will modifies into ovum immediately, that will fuse with the sperm. Okay, so that you have to know which protein is required for this. Anaphase promoting factor is required for that. Is it clear? Anaphase promoting factor is required to complete meiosis II. Okay, meiosis II will be completed, that will form a second polar body and a wooted. Along with this, the first polar body is there, no? Here the first polar body also completes meiosis II, that leads to formation of two more polar bodies. It is meiosis II marked here. It is meiosis II. In meiosis II, what will happen is the secondary oocyte complete meiosis II, which is arrested in metaphase. Now it is completed in the fallopian tubes when the sperm will come in contact to secondary oocyte. That leads to formation of a small second polar body and a large wooted. Wooted will undergo metamorphosis and modifies into ovum. And first polar body also completes meiosis II, that leads to formation of two more polar bodies. So total how many polar bodies and how many ova this wooted will form? How many polar bodies and how many ova are produced by a single oogonium or primary oocyte? From a single oogonium or primary oocyte, how many ova and how many polar bodies are produced here? Observe here carefully. From a single primary oocyte, how many polar bodies? 1, 2, 3. How many polar bodies? 1, 2, 3 polar bodies are formed. And how many ova are produced? A single ovum is produced. Only one ovum. So from a primary oocyte, one ovum and three polar bodies are produced. One ovum and three polar bodies are produced. Polar bodies will be degenerated soon. Okay, that cannot modify into ovum. That you have to remember. But whereas in spermatogenesis, one primary spermatocyte can modify into four spermatozoa. One primary spermatocyte will form four spermatozoa. But what about here? Here, one primary oocyte will produce only one ovum. 1:1. One will modify into one ovum. But how many polar bodies? Three polar bodies. And one more thing you may notice here. The first polar body undergo meiosis II and form two new polar bodies. These polar bodies, which are produced by first polar body, not by any oocyte. So this is polar body formed by primary oocyte. It is also polar body formed by secondary oocyte. But what about these two? These two are not formed by any oocyte. It is formed by first polar body itself. By the division of first polar body, we got here two new cells. We can call these two as polocytes. So it is more depth. Just remember, if they will ask anywhere, what is polocyte? The two cells which are formed by the division of first polar body are known as polocytes. But commonly all together we are calling as polar bodies only. But in depth, if anywhere, they will ask. So what are polocytes? That are formed by the division of polar bodies. Polocytes are formed by the division of polar bodies. So now tell me how many polar bodies and how many porosites are formed here. There is formation of two polar bodies. It is one polar body by primary oocyte. It is another polar body by secondary oocyte. How many porosites? Two porosites. Like that also they may ask in exam. Total how many polar bodies and how many ovum? It is general for your level, for your standard it's enough. Three polar bodies and one ovum. From a primary oocyte, three polar bodies and one ovum will be produced. Okay, so here three polar bodies and one ovum is produced. Already I told you secondary oocyte begins meiosis II in tertiary follicle. Meiosis II in tertiary follicle, but it cannot complete meiosis II there. Why it cannot complete meiosis II there? There is releasing of one factor, metaphase promoting factor. The name itself suggests the function. It always keep the cell in metaphase. Metaphase promoting factor. So it promotes which phase? Only metaphase. So the cell cannot move forward. The cell will be arrested in metaphase only. The cell will be arrested in metaphase only. So the meiosis II is arrested in the metaphase. But after releasing into the body cavity, this secondary oocyte will be collected by the fimbriae of infundibulum that will enter through the fallopian tube. In the fallopian tube, when the sperm will come in contact with the ovum, that will stimulate the release of one more protein in the ovum, that is anaphase promoting factor. Anaphase promoting factor. So whenever anaphase promoting factor will be released, that will automatically suppress the metaphase promoting factor. Metaphase promoting factor will be automatically deactivated when anaphase releasing factor will be released. Then anaphase releasing factor will causes for the movement of cell from the metaphase to anaphase. Now the cell will escape from the metaphase and enters into anaphase. Anaphase is the last phase of the cell division. So whenever it will enters into anaphase, the cell cycle will be completed and the secondary oocyte will escape from the metaphase and it will complete meiosis II, that leads to formation of two unequal cells. One is the small second polar body, another one is large wooted will modifies into ovum. So by this, there is formation of three polar bodies and one ovum. Three polar bodies and one ovum. So one primary oocyte or one gugonium will produce three polar bodies and one ovum. They may ask next them to produce 1000 ova, how many primary oocytes are required? To produce 1000 ova, how many primary oocytes are required? Already I told you, number of primary oocytes is equal to number of ova. So here, to produce 1000 ova, 1000 primary oocytes are required. To produce 1000 ova, how many secondary oocytes are required? That's also same, 1000. To produce 1000 ova, how many oogonia are required? That's also same, 1000. So 1 is to 1. But whereas in male reproductive system, 1 is to 4. 1 is to 4 in the spermatogenesis, that you have to remember. So this is the oogenesis. Oogenesis, is it clear? Once again, I will just repeat this. One of the complex process, one of the very complex process series. So now we will continue this. Once again, we will recall all the topics what we discussed here. Just observe oogenesis here. See, oogenesis is the process of production of female gametes or ova in the ovarian follicles of the ovaries. This process will begin in the fetal life, but it will be completed only after puberty. After 10 to 12 years only, the production of first ovum will take place by the female. Okay, it is a long time taking process. It begins in the 7th month of embryonic development, but completes after 10 to 12 years of time, right? In the ovaries, ovary is externally covered by germinal epithelium. In the germinal epithelium, the primordial themselves will undergo repeated mitotic divisions that leads to formation of a couple of million or 2 millions of ova, 2 millions of oogonia in each ovary. In each ovary, there is no chances for adding of oogonia further in the lifetime. That will form only once. So total 4 millions of oogonia are produced in a female. In each ovary, 2 million, so total 4 million of oogonia will be produced. So that is the first phase, multiplication phase. Multiplication phase, what will happen? Primordial germ cells or female germ cells will undergo repeated mitotic divisions that leads to formation of 2 million oogonia in each ovary. That's completed. And after formation of that oogonia in female, oogonia leads to formation of ovarian follicles. In this, during the phase between fetal life to puberty, many changes will be done. The follicles will grow in size and finally modifies into mature follicle after puberty. Okay, so the second phase, growth phase, will take 10 to 12 years of time. The longest period in the oogenesis is the growth phase, because the follicles will begin the growth in the fetal life, but that will be completed after puberty. Along with that, there is the growth and modifications takes place in the oocyte. Okay, maturation divisions also begin, but they're not completed until the puberty. Okay, right. Next, oogonia will enters into the stroma in the form of once again, ma'am, just listen. Right. Okay. So here, listen carefully. There is formation of egg tube of Legge. Okay. So it is egg tube of Legge modified into egg nest. In each egg nest, only one oogonium modifies into primary oocyte. Remaining all will modifies into follicular epithelium, which is known as primordial follicle. Later, these plant cells or squamous cells of primordial follicle will modifies into large arthropodial cells, that is the primary follicle. In the primary follicle, the primary oocyte begins meiosis 1, but it is temporarily arrested due to lack of sufficient levels of estrogen. This will temporarily arrest in prophase 1, the diploid phase of prophase 1. Later, this single layer of membrana granulosa, now it is primary follicle, already I told you. So a single layer of membrana granulosa will modifies into a multi-layered, that leads to create a pressure on the stromal tissue, which will here observe. This stromal tissue, that leads to condensation of stromal tissue, that will form two more layers that are known as theca layers. The two theca layers are theca interna and theca externa. Theca interna and theca externa. Theca interna secretes estrogen. Due to lack of estrogen, it is arrested. But now estrogen is available. So in next phase, in tertiary follicle, the primary oocyte will complete meiosis 1. That leads to formation of two unequal cells. First polar body and secondary oocyte, that also we have to remember. Is it clear? So now, when it takes place in the tertiary follicle, how secondary follicle is converted into tertiary follicle? The membrana granulosa will split into two layers, inner layer and outer layer, that will create a space, or that will form a cavity. That cavity will immediately filled with a fluid that is secreted by the granulosa cells, which is known as antrum. Antrum is the fluid filled cavity, and the fluid which is present in the antrum is known as Likert folliculi. So that Likert folliculi is also secreted by the granulosa cells. So now membrana granulosa split into two layers, inner layer and outer layer. In between them there is an antrum. So the inner layer is known as corona radiata, and outer is a normal membrana granulosa. And after that, what will happen here in tertiary follicle? Secondary primary oocyte complete meiosis 1, that leads to formation of secondary oocyte and first polar body. Now the secondary oocyte itself secrete a membrane around it, that is zona pellucida. So in tertiary follicle, there is formation of 5 membranes around the oocyte. The innermost is zona pellucida. Immediately after to zona pellucida, corona radiata. After that, membrana granulosa and theca interna, and outermost is theca externa. But you may notice is a fluid filled cavity between membrana granulosa and corona radiata here, that is antrum. And to connect membrana granulosa with corona radiata, there is a group of elevated granulosa cells, which is known as cumulus oophoricus. That is tertiary follicle. Tertiary follicle will grow in size and modifies into mature follicle or graafian follicle. This mature follicle or graafian follicle will reach towards the surface, and that leads to rupture of surface of ovary. And after that, the hormone, luteinizing hormone, will causes for the rupture of theca externa, theca interna, membrana, granulosa layers. And then the secondary oocyte along with the secondary oocyte along with zona pellucida and zona pellucida and corona radiata will release into body cavity. So in human being, the release of secondary oocyte from the Graafian follicle into body cavity is known as ovulation. You have to notice one thing here, ma'am. It is secondary oocyte which is divided and form two cells, first polar body and secondary oocyte. Now observe here, along the secondary oocyte, where the polar body also there? It is also there inside, no? Inside the zona pellucida only, along the secondary oocyte, polar body also present. So polar body also releases along with the secondary oocyte. Along with secondary oocyte, polar body also releases, that you have to remember. So secondary oocyte, polar body, around that which is there, around that there is a zona, sorry. One second, listen here. So it is a polar body, it is a secondary oocyte, it is zona pellucida, it is corona radiata. So now it is released. Next, where the meiosis II will be completed? Meiosis II will be completed in the fallopian tube. Both polar body and secondary oocyte complete meiosis II in the fallopian tube only. So when meiosis II takes place, whenever anaphase promoting factor will releases, then only meiosis II takes place, either in fallopian tube, either in polar body or in the oocyte, secondary oocyte. Meiosis II will take place only after releasing of anaphase releasing factor. When this anaphase releasing factor will releases, when the sperm will come in contact with the ovum, when a sperm will come in contact with the ovum, then only anaphase releasing factor will releases. So meiosis II, either in polar body or in secondary oocyte, both will take place in the fallopian tubes only. Okay, meiosis II begins in the tertiary follicle, but finish at that will be completed at fallopian tube. Both polar bodies as well as secondary oocyte will complete meiosis II there only. So that we have to remember. So meiosis II means it is completed only in the fallopian tube after releasing of anaphase releasing factor, either in first polar body or in secondary oocyte. That also we have to remember, right? After that, secondary oocyte will modifies. Secondary oocyte will divided by meiosis II and form two unequal cells again, that is second polar body and ootid. Ootid will undergo metamorphosis, so we will discuss that. How ootid will modify into ovum, we will discuss later. Just remember this, ovum will be produced. So one oogonium or one primary oocyte will produce one ovum and three polar bodies. One ovum and three polar bodies there. That we have to remember. Is it clear? They may ask in exam, what is the number of ova? You all know that in every menstrual cycle, that is 28 to 30 days of time period in a female human being, in every menstrual cycle there is a production of one ovum at the middle of the cycle, that is that 14th day of menstrual cycle, there is production of one ovum. But in human being, without copulation or without insemination or without contact with the sperm, the secondary oocyte cannot undergo meiosis II, so there is no chances of production of ovum. So they may ask in exam, what is the number of ova produced by an unmarried female? What is the number of ova produced by an unmarried female in 3 months of time? What is the number of ova? Usually in other animals means we can consider that as a ovum, so there are three ova produced. But here in unmarried female means what the actual question they are going to ask, there is no insemination, there is no copulation. If there is no copulation, there is no production of ovum by a female. So here the female can produce only secondary oocytes, not ovum, without copulation or without insemination. Is it clear? So you have to choose the option 0. Even they will ask 5 years or 12 years, whatever the time. Once again, listen, for every year, in every month, one ovum, so total 12 ova may produced by a female human being. But here, the ova means it is actually secondary oocyte only, not a true comb. Whenever copulation done, whenever insemination will be done, whenever sperm will come in contact with secondary oocyte, then only secondary oocyte will modify into ovum. So in an unmarried female, there is no chances for production of ovum. Without insemination, there will be no chances for modification of secondary oocyte into ovum. That you have to remember. Is it clear? But if there is copulation and insemination, then only secondary oocyte will modify into ovum. Otherwise, there is no chances for production of ovum. Okay. So ovum, if they will ask particularly ovum, zero. Secondary oocytes means for every menstrual cycle one. So for every month there is one secondary oocyte. Whenever copulation, then only there is chances for releasing of modification of secondary oocyte into ovum. That you have to remember. Up to that you will remember. Now ovum is released. That is secondary oocyte is released along with the zone of pellucidal corona radiata. Then what is the fate of this graafian follicle? What is the fate of graafian follicle after releasing of secondary oocyte? This graafian follicle, that is ruptured graafian follicle, will modifies into a temporary endocrine gland, corpus luteum, that secrete progesterone. So we will discuss all that details in next class. Thank you.